Ability to load the vehicle with due regard for safety rules and proper vehicle use. This section compromises of a series of questions that are based around the correct loading of the vehicle. This will be your ability to tell the examiner your knowledge of the weights, loading of luggage, passengers and wheelchairs correctly. Okay, here's a question. How can you ensure the vehicle is loaded correctly prior to setting off? Now think about it. The answer is this. All luggage is evenly stored so that the weight is evenly distributed and at its lowest point. Ensure that all luggage compartments are locked and secure. Any luggage in overhead saloon compartments is secure and not unstable. No luggage or obstructions have been left in the saloon aisle. All passengers are seated and wearing seatbelts if fitted. The vehicle is not over exceeding the set passenger capability. All pushchairs and wheelchairs are in any designated bay with the brakes on and belts worn if fitted. The next question they may ask you. What requirements would you need to be able to carry a wheelchair user on your bus or coach? The answer. Kneeling system that goes up and down. Low floor. Non-stepped entrance. So that means they can freely wheel in. Obviously you would need a ramp and a designated bay to park them in. Next question. How would you load a wheelchair and what checks would you carry out? Here's the answers. Pull up close to the curb. Apply the handbrake. Select neutral. Cancel your indicator. Ask if they require assistance. Lower the vehicle. Deploy the ramp. Place the wheelchair in the designated bay. Handlebars of the wheelchair either side of the backrest. Wheelchair pulled back to extend the wheelbase. Brakes are on. That's brakes on the actual wheelchair. Straps and belts are secure if required. Give assistance where required, especially with passengers of disabilities. What that basically means is offer to help. Okay, the next question. You've just boarded a wheelchair user. What checks would you carry out prior to setting off? Now have a think. The answers. Ensure that the wheelchair has the brakes or straps locked. Redeploy the ramp, ensuring it's fully in place. Close the doors. Ensure everyone is seated. All luggage is stored correctly. Complete a full all-round obfuscation check, such as blind spots and mirror checks. And final near-side mirror check for any late intending passengers. Security of your vehicle and contents demonstration. This section demonstrates your ability to check the interior of the vehicle with regards to seat belts, seats and anything attached to them or the saloon. So basically, we're talking about the seat belts. What are we looking for? They extend. Condition of the belt, no cuts or frays, and they are clean. It locks. There's tension. Secure at all points. It releases and retracts. Where fitted, they must be worn. Extra assistance to be given for passengers with certain disabilities, such if they're blind or they're very dyslexic. Ensure there are signs of giving instruction of using the seatbelts. Normally you would have some sort of signage on the window to display on how to use the seatbelt. Next question. Seats and anything attached to them. So you're going to check the seat for security, making sure it is safe. Secure to the floor and all. No fractures or fatigue anywhere in the frame. The backrest and back base are secure. The fabric has no cuts, tears or foam spilling out. Nothing is sharp. No wet patches or anything that could soil anyone's clothing, chewing gum or graffiti. Demonstrate a seat belt as above. Handle rails are secure with on sharp edges that could harm them. Basically saying you're checking the railings to make sure there's nothing that is sharp that could cut someone, basically. All the bell pushes work. Additionally to that, check the actual button and the signage for the bus stopping is working as well. The next question, saloon. Demonstrate the seat and anything attached to them as above. So we were going to be checking the passenger area of the bus or coach. So you want to check the roof, no leaks or loose panels. Lights are working, no leaks, loose fittings, no wires exposed. Windows are in their seals and no leaks, no etchings, graffiti and clean. Side panels are secure with no sharp edges and clean. Any heater housings have no sharp edges that could harm passengers' legs and aren't leaking. The floor is clear of any trip hazards. Any access hatches are locked and there's lost property or suspicious packages. Making sure the floor is clean and have no obstructions that anyone could trip over. Any steps have no loose edges that would cause anyone to trip and fall. Emergency exit is clearly labelled as how to operate it. Opens 90 degrees. Hinges are sound. The warning alarm sounds. The step area is clear of obstructions. The door shuts security and securely and the alarm goes off. So basically you're listening to that alarm in the cab and basically everything is secure with the emergency exit. Emergency window exit is clearly labelled how to operate and there's a hammer present. So if need be, the hammer can be used to smash the rear window. The rear window does need to be signposted as emergency exit and tells people how to basically operate the emergency exit. Where there are a multiple of items such as seats, handrails, bell pushes and windows, then continue to check them, explaining that you'd complete the same check as mentioned earlier. Right, the next stage is the ability to prevent criminality, trafficking in illegal immigrants demonstration. You must be able to carry out a full immigration check on your vehicle for the examiner with regards to the security of the vehicle, ensuring that there are none of the following found: hidden bodies, contraband, drugs and explosives. It is a legal requirement to wear gloves when carrying out the exercise. This is to prevent the risk of contamination, any evidence of harming yourself. Also, you will be fined up to £2,000 if found not wearing them. Doors. It is essential that all doors are closed during the exercise. This is to demonstrate your awareness of anyone intruding during this complete check of the vehicle. Okay, the question. The internal check. So what are you going to check? You're going to check the cab area. Overhead compartments in the cab. First aid box. All seats. Litter bins. Floors. Access hatches. All overhead lockers, all luggage racks, toilet, kitchen area. Any compartment that requires any key to access, explain that if you had a key, you would open all lockable areas. So basically, you're checking all the nooks and crannies in the vehicle. External check. The roof. Underneath the vehicle, open any panel that opens. All filler caps, wheel arches, wheel drum, that basically means the holes in between the wheel drums, the air vents for the braking system, because there's holes all the way around the wheel. Luggage compartments, radiator and grill, that's on the outside obviously. Emergency exit, engine compartment, so that this is the one time you would open the boot compartment so you could have a visual check. Boot or rear luggage area of a coach. So in the case of a coach, you would have a door with all the luggage in it. Possibly a trailer. The exhaust system. And driver's accommodation. Sometimes the coach driver accommodation is in the luggage compartment. And sometimes it's on the coach itself. Any compartment that requires any key to access, explain that if you had a key, you would open all lockable areas. The next question, passenger check. Upon the completion of checking the entire vehicle, you must explain that before boarding your passengers, you would check the following. The passenger list, or the manifesto, or documentation. Tickets, passports, and then do a final onboard head count. Okay, the next question, or sequence of questions. The ability to access emergency situations. You must be able to deal with varying types of situations of emergency to ensure the safety of your passenger, yourself, the vehicle, and other motorists. So just think about these questions before I give you the answers and put yourself in this scenario and think of what you need to think of. Where and how can a fire start on a vehicle? So just think about taking the body off the vehicle. What are the mechanical parts that could start a fire? So let's run through it. The engine, fuel lines, a hot exhaust system, transmission, wheels, brakes, tires. Then you have the interior, such as luggage compartments, overhead lockers, passenger areas. Biggest thing being the chair themselves catching fire. Toilets, kitchen areas, the cab area, it could be an electrical fault, driver's sleeping quarters, and loiterers around the bus, such as around the shelters, arsonists, people around the vehicle basically. So let's move on to the next question. Whilst driving on the motorway, you discover flames coming from the engine and wheel arch. What do you do? First of all, you pull over onto the hard shoulder as soon as it's safe to do so. Secure the vehicle. Put the handbrake on, put it into neutral, turn the engine off. Locate the fuel cutoff switch if possible. Evacuate the passengers off the vehicle via the most appropriate exit. Now, you're on a motorway, so you're not going to use the emergency exit on the offside. Keeping the passengers together, over the barrier, up or down the banking, take them upwind, because you don't want them inhaling smoke, and then contact the emergency services. You can do that by using one of the provided telephones on the high shoulder, or use a mobile phone. So let's move on to the next question. Similar scenario, except we're not on the motorway. Whilst driving, you notice flames coming from the engine, the wheel arch. What do you do? Pull the vehicle up somewhere safe. Nowhere near a school, petrol station, factory, housing or a built up area. Secure the vehicle. Put the handbrake on, put it into neutral, turn the engine off. Locate the fuel cutoff switch if possible, so you want to cut the fuel supply. Evacuate the passengers off the vehicle via the most appropriate exit, keeping the passengers together, away from the vehicle or around the corner if possible. Taking them upwind, again away from the smoke, and then contact the emergency service. As an extra note, what coloured labels on a fire extinguisher would you not use on an electrical fire? The answer is red. You would not use water. Okay, the last question. Ability to prevent physical risk demonstration. This section allows you to be able to demonstrate your ability to ensure your vehicle is safe and legal to use on the road before leaving the depot. It is a legal requirement for you to complete a full walk-around check of the vehicle before leaving the yard, from the cab and the exterior. Can you show me how you would carry out your check? You're involved in a small accident. What would your course of action be? Pull the vehicle up as soon as possible and as safe to do so. Secure the vehicle, handbrake on, put it into neutral, turn engine off. Switch on your hazard warning lights. Isolate the vehicle's electrics. Ensure the passengers' welfare, such as injuries, obtain medical assistance if required. Check for the third party's safety, the person you've had the accident with. Exchange the third party's details, such as insurance and address details, that sort of thing. Obtain witness details, so you may ask your passengers to be a witness, so you would need to take their name and address and contact number. Phone for assistance if need be. Obviously, you'd probably be ringing the police. Direct traffic if you're causing an obstruction. Next question. There are many protrusions on a vehicle. What are they? What dangers do they pose? And how can these incidents be avoided? The front overhang of your vehicle, the rear overhang of your vehicle, and both near side and off side mirrors, both mirrors left and right. Danger they may cause is pulling in and out of bus stops, possibly hitting pedestrians, striking other motorists, striking pedestrians, including intending or aligning passengers, basically passengers coming on and off your vehicle. Striking street furniture, such as signposts. All the above with the overhangs and mirrors can be avoided by making good use of all-round observations, such as mirrors and blind spot checks. Next question. How and what visual aids would you check on a frosty, wintry morning? So put yourself in that position. It's early morning, December, It's freezing cold, it's been snowing, and it's icy. What do you need to do? Think about your own car. Windows and windscreens are clean and clear. Wipers and washers work. The vehicle's antifreeze levels and screen wash are topped up. Demisters work. Mirrors are clean and clear. Heated windscreen and mirrors are working if fitted. All your lights are clean and working. Reversing camera works. Keep in mind, if you did have a reversing camera, it may be a bit frosted on the lens, so that might take a little while to warm up due to condensation. Next question. You're given a vehicle you're unfamiliar with. What extra checks would you carry out to ensure the safety of your passengers? Complete a full and rigorous daily vehicle check. Familiarise myself with all the switches, dials, safety components. Ensure I know where the fire extinguisher and emergency exits are. Be aware of the vehicle's dimensions, because obviously it'd be different to your normal vehicle. It may have maybe a double decker instead of a single decker. It might be longer, wider, it might be more heavier, have more seating capability. Complete a risk assessment on the required route for your dimensions, such as bridges and weight restrictions. Refer to the operator's manual. There may be an operator's manual you can read up on what all the various things do on your bus you're using that day. So that's the CPC, module 4. I hope this recording helps you. One last thing regarding weights. Know your weights. Can you show me where the unladen weight is labelled on the vehicle? Now that will always be on the near side, and it will have the registered address underneath it. This will be followed by a series of questions relating to the weight of passengers, luggage and fuel. I'll just give you a rough breakdown on what those figures are. 15 passengers is equal to 1 ton. 30 passengers equal to 2 tons. 45 passengers, 3 tons. 60 passengers, 4 tons. 75 passengers, 5 tons. Now, 15 cases of luggage will typically weigh 330 kilograms. 30 cases, around 660 kilograms, and 45 cases, 990 kilograms, roughly a ton. 250 litres of fuel will weigh approximately 250 kilograms. Just keep these figures in mind, because obviously the instructor may ask you